Accounting Standard 15, Employee Benefits.
Okay.
What do you understand by Employee Benefits? Provident Fund, okay. Someone said PF, someone said Retirement Benefits. Okay, what is Retirement Benefits? Retirement Benefits, you are saying Gratuity? And? Leave Encashment. Okay, Leave Encashment is not retirement, right? Encashment is only at retirement.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a big topic. We'll discuss it in detail. Leave encashment. Pension. PF I have written. What else? NPS. It's also retirement. New pension scheme, so it's pension. Yes, okay. Mediclaim. Mediclaim premium is paid by? One second. Mediclaim premium is paid by? Employer? No. We are discussing employee benefits. We are not discussing retirement benefits. Okay, retirement benefits is part of employee benefits. So our topic is employee benefits. Retirement benefit is a subtopic. So leave travel. Okay, various types of allowances. Salary. Bonus. So various allowances. Okay.
Group insurance.
So various reimbursement or allowances, I'll put it in one. Anything else? More than enough, right? Okay, various allowances. You might have various types of allowances. I've clubbed it in one. Transport allowance, children allowance, education allowance, whatever. Many allowances.
Study
leave. Okay. So leave encashment can have, so basically let's make it a big a macro thing, leaves, okay, paid leaves, which we call it. Okay, now paid leaves can have a sub portion of leave encashment. Paid leaves can have your normal sick leave, your as you said, study leave. So there can be various components of your paid leaves.
Leave encashment is actually earned leave. Earned leave can be.
I understand. So I'm saying there are paid leaves. Out of those paid leaves, there are some leaves which you can encash, and some leaves which get over in the same year. That means you cannot carry forward. So some lapse and some you can carry forward. Out of some which you can carry forward, you can encash some of them. So I'm saying a macro point which I am saying is paid leaves. Paid leaves can have sub portions. Long term training. So education, I can put it in under allowance or various other other types of benefits you might get. But these are the basic ones or the macro ones. Now, first of all, let us understand what is an employee. Okay. The standard does not define what is an employee, but there is an inclusive definition. That means employee includes these things. Okay, so it says full-time employee, part-time employee, permanent employee, casual employee, temporary basis employee. So employee, any of these will fall under the definition of employee, even if it is part-time, even if it is temporary employment. Employee also includes whole time directors and managerial persons. So those are also employees. In fact, it says employee benefits, which has been pointed out here, can also be paid to spouse, children, or any other dependent. So those will also fall under employee benefits. Okay. These are some of the benefits which I have tried to note down, which is salaries, bonus, medical care, housing, cars, food, subsidized food, paid leaves, gratuity, pension, sabbatical leaves. Okay, we did not write sabbatical leaves. Okay, study leave is one kind of sabbatical leave. Any disability benefits, and then there is a VRS scheme. Okay, now they have classified employee benefits into four types, major four types, which is short term, other long term. Why other long term? Because post employment is also long term and termination is also long term. Hence, short term, post employment, termination, and other long term. These are the four basic classifications. It says short term means, examples are wages or salary, bonus, paid annual leaves, medical care, housing, cars, free or subsidized goods. The point here is it should be payable within 12 months from the end of the year. So anything which is payable within 12 months from the end of the year is short term. Other long term means long service leave, sabbatical leaves, long term disability benefits, any deferred compensation, which is not payable within 12 months from the end of the year. Post employment, something which is payable after completion of employment, gratuity, pension, or any post employment insurance, or medical care post insurance, post employment medical care, any other retirement benefits which we are missing. And last is termination benefits. Termination benefits are of two types. One is notice pay. So, you know, one if you are you know, handed over the pink slip, then the notice pay is what you get. That is one type of termination benefit. The other is VRS, voluntary retirement scheme. These are the basic classifications. Now, why do we classify benefits into four types or four parts? Basically, it is for the purpose of accounting. Now, short-term benefits will be simply accounted like salaries. We just account it every month. Okay. So, short-term, it's simple. We just account it. Whereas long-term, it says that you will have to do actuarial valuation. So whether it is post-employment or it is other long-term, you will have to consider whether actuarial valuation is required or not. And then there is termination benefit. Termination benefit, because of the nature, you will come to know of those benefits only when it's time to terminate. That means when we have floated VRS scheme, or when the employee is handed over a pink slip, or the employee has put in his resignation. These are the times when you come to know about the termination, and hence termination benefits, because of its nature, you don't go for actuarial valuation or discounting or any such things. So these are the basic four types. Let us go one by one and understand each of them. Short term, as I said, is very simple. There is no discounting, no actuarial valuation, simple charge to your income and expenditure account, right? Short term, we said, is salary, bonus, all those types. Okay, let us come to a very important topic, which is compensated absences or paid leaves. Okay, how do you account for paid leaves? First of all, let me understand the structure of paid leaves that you get. How many leaves do you get in a year? 38 or 30? 30. 30 leaves and 8. Okay, 30 EL, 8 CL. Huh? How many of it can you carry forward? 20. 30 and 20 you can carry forward. 8.
8, no. Within the year.
Okay, up to 300 days. That means before the end of next year. One second. 2013 में जो आपने 30 leaves earn किया होगा,
for next year.
Suppose next year में वो 30 leaves use नहीं होते.
Three hundred leaves
I can carry forward up to retirement. Okay. So not 300 days, 300 leaves. Okay. Up to 300 leaves I can carry forward up till retirement. Okay. Can it be encashed on retirement?
Yes.
Okay. Huh. Okay. This 8 CL will lapse in the same year?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, 20 HPL you can carry forward till retirement. No limit. Can you encash it? Please, one at a time, please. Yes. Huh.
So suppose it takes a shortage of values is
300 and whatever the shortage is then the benchmark can take it. So it can be encashed. Up to 300, up to this. So basically this EL plus HPL maximum you can encash is 300.
Yes, that is correct. Yes, yes.
Fine. Now, how do you account for these leaves? Suppose a person does not take any leave, or a person takes only this 8 CL. So, forget this 8 CL. A person does not take any leave out of this 30 and 20. How do you account for it?
It is accumulated.
No, no. I am not talking about it is exceeding 300. Forget 300. It is the first year. So, a person has not taken any leave during the year. Entire 50 leaves is carry forward. How do you account for it? There is no accounting, only there is a register in which we write that 50 leaves carry forward. And we keep on counting till it is 300. After 300, we don't carry forward. I understand. The first year might be 30, but otherwise it can be carried.
Only it is accounted in the study leave account. There is no impact in the account.
There is no impact in the account.
There is no impact.
Okay.
Impact.
Should there be an impact in the accounts?
Yes, should be there.
And why so?
It is wrong.
It is a def.
One second. He has something to say. Yes.
Sir, it is a def.
Hello.
Expenditure.
It is not. We are not accounting every year. It is a wrong concept. I think so. Why? Every year we do the actuarial valuation. In actuarial valuation, leave encashment is one of the part. Leave encashment. How much leave is accrued to each and every employee at the end of the year? So we do the actuarial valuation. Based on that, we make the provision, which gets debited into the income expenditure account.
Okay. Why do you need to account for such things?
Sir.
Why it's a liability?
It is a liability.
Because 300 can be encashed. That's
it is,
why.
It is a liability.
Okay. Suppose it could not be encashed.
The purpose of actuarial valuation is, if today, what is my, if the full leave is encashed, what would be my actual liability? This is actuarial valuation. Based on that, company has some liability as on date towards all employees of the institute.
Okay.
Suppose
leaves cannot be encashed. Will you still do accounting for these leaves? Will you still do actuarial valuation?
No. Suppose any leave in excess of 300, there should not be any valuation. The company institute is liable to encash up to 300 days maximum.
Okay, that means you are saying that if
300 days or actual leave due, whichever is
I got your point. You are saying that only because it is encashable, That is why we do the accounting, that is why we do actuarial valuation. If it was not encashable, we would not go for any accounting or any actuarial valuation.
Yes. Whenever any employee retires, we then debit the provision account.
So this means only when there is a cash outflow, I will think of accounting for a expense. If there is no cash flow, there is no accounting.
Why there is no accounting? When I am doing the actuarial valuation and I am taking hit in my IE, of course it is affecting my viability, profitability, and the absorption surplus reduces to that extent.
But you are saying we are doing this only because it is encashable. Suppose yes. Leaves were not encashable.
Yes, of course. Liability is there. When liability is there, we are recognizing the liability every year.
Liability is there because it is encashable.
It is encashable.
Suppose it was not encashable.
Then no liability, no provision.
Okay. How many working days are there in a year?
Will depend on.
How many working days are there in a year without these paid leaves? Without these paid leaves. How many working days are there in a year? Suppose we remove Sundays, we remove Saturdays, and we remove public holidays.
240, around 240.
What I mean to say is, when a salary is paid, okay, let's do a very rough calculation. Let's not go on the actuals. 365 days a year, 52 Sundays, 52 Saturdays, and say some 20 public holidays. Suppose just random I am saying. So basically, working days would be some 265 minus 25, so some 260, 240. 240 working days. Out of this 240 working days, I am getting some 58 leaves. Suppose let's take it as 40 leaves. So basically 200 working days in a year, right? I am just taking rough calculation. Okay. Suppose a person is paid 2 lakh rupees per annum. Okay. This 2 lakh rupees per annum is paid for 200 working days.
We are all 24/7 employees, sir. Don't say that.
No. See, if let's not think from employee's angle. Let's think from employer's angle. Right, accounting is done for the employer, is done for the institution.
I have 1.2 million.
Right, let's think from the employer's angle. If I am an employer, I want to hire an employee. Hello? I want to pay some 2 lakh rupees per annum. I am paying that 2 lakh rupees for these 200 days because rest all is either holidays or leaves.
Hello?
And suppose he takes leaves, he consumes all the leaves. If he does not consume, I have to anyways pay. And if he consumes, then I am paying him for 200 days. So this 2 lakh is for 200 days, right?
Hello.
Hello. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Good. So I am paying 2 lakh rupees for 200 days. Suppose he does not take any leaves. He works for 250 days. He is still getting this 2 lakhs?
Yes.
But
he
will get the benefit afterwards.
He might get the benefit afterwards. No, one second. He might get the benefit afterwards. Suppose in the next year, he takes 50 days leave of this year and 50 days leave of the next year also. He takes 100 days leave in the next year. So what he is doing is, he is working for 100 days and still getting 2 lakhs. In 1 year, he is working for 250 days and still getting 2 lakhs. In next year, he is working for 100 days and still getting 2 lakhs. Now if I am an employer, okay, see, when an employee works every day, he is giving me some benefit in terms of revenue. Can I associate some revenue with every employee? That means, agar wo ek din kaam karega, to kuch revenue generate hoga. Agar wo 200 din kaam karega, to 200 times that revenue generate hoga. Right? Now, we have heard of matching concept. Every time someone earns some money, we have to charge something to the income and expenditure account. So, every time an employee works for a day, we have to charge his 1 day's salary to the accounts. Right? So if he's expected to work for 200 days, he generates some revenue for 200 days for me, and I am paying him 2 lakh rupees for those 200 days. Next year, so when he works for 250 days in the same year, what happens is he is generating revenue 250 times. But my charge to the P&L is only for 200 times. Are you with me?
Yes.
Yes. Next year, he is generating only for 100 days. He is generating revenue for only 100 days, but I am making a payment for 200 days. That means there is no matching concept. Are you agreeing with me? So suppose there is no leave encashment, there is no encashment happening. Still, for matching concept, I should do at least some accounting so that every year, whatever revenue he earns per day, there is a charge per day. Are you with me?
Yes.
That is why you have this actuarial valuation or you have this accrual basis accounting. So whenever a leave can be carried forward, there should be some credit or income in the current year. Are you with me?
Yes.
That means he has worked for 250 days. I am paying him for 200 days. I should charge P&L for another 50 days in the current year. And next year when he is taking leaves of 50 extra, I should give income of those 50 days in the next year. So what I am doing is I am transferring some expenditure in the current year which should ideally come in the next year. Let me expand this or let me 200 din ka 2 lakh rupiah, which is 1000 rupees per day. Suppose he earns for me 2000 rupees per day. He has worked for 250 days in a year, in this year. I am paying him 2 lakhs. He should ideally earn me 4 lakhs, but he is earning for me 5 lakhs in this year. Next year, I again pay him 2 lakhs. He should ideally earn 4 lakhs again for me, but he is earning only 2 lakhs. I think this should be 6 and this should be 2, something like this. What I should do now is, I should charge some expense over here and I should give some income over here. Because I am paying 2 lakhs, I am not getting 2 lakhs worth. I am paying here 2 lakhs, I am getting worth more than 2 lakhs. This accounting is accrual basis accounting and hence you should go for actuarial valuation. Whether there is encashment or no encashment. Actuarial valuation is required wherever there is leaves which you can carry forward for more than 1 year. So if it is less than 12 months you can carry forward, it is short-term benefit. Short-term benefit, there is no actuarial valuation. But if it can be carried forward for more than 12 months, then actuarial valuation is required.
This system is to be followed. Then the salary component and the leave encashment component will come separately in the bills also. So it will be inconsistent with the government present system. So the policy is to come from the higher level actually. Otherwise preparation of the salary bill will undergo massive changes.
This will be charged as provision for leave encashment. Now you are also charging provision for leave encashment.
No, conceptually it is understood, sir. Conceptually there is no problem. Conceptually there is no problem at all. What you have explained, it is well understood also. But point is that we prepare 30 days or 31 days salary bill. Now if you are explaining this, then certain portion is actuarial portion which has to come from that actuarial fund which has been created, and some portion has to come from the salary head.
Now you do actuarial valuation?
Yeah, we do actuarial valuation.
When you do actuarial valuation, what data do you give to actuary?
No, this we don't include in actuarial valuation.
No, how do you know that?
Actuary
kya karta hai calculation? Have you ever seen? Have you tried to understand from the actuary what calculations he does? Wo actuary report de deta, apan provision kar dete hai, without understanding what goes into that calculation.
That is true? Yeah.
I am sure actuary would take this into account.
The point is not that, sir.
Actuary only takes the data that what are the leaves in credit in the annual account. They never
ask
how many days
this employee has worked. Sir, now the problem.
When I know how many leaves he has taken in the current year, there are two things which I will estimate. Okay? One second, listen to me. When I know how many leaves he has taken in the current year, when I know his accumulated leave till now, there are two things which I will consider. How many leaves is he expected to take in the years to come before retirement? That means out of the accumulated leave and the next year's leave. how many leaves is he expected to take before retirement? See, normally it is a tendency that if there is 301 leave, even if we don't require one leave, we will go and take that leave. That actuary will consider. When he considers that, he will charge you, or he will create that, he will the expense which he will give you will include that one day's extra leave, which that employee will definitely take. So in the assumptions which the actuary take, he takes this into account, that how many leaves are you going to take before retirement.
So that is very
and well how many leaves you will encash after retirement. If that's the case, you know, once a person touches 300 leaves accumulated, the actuary will not charge anything to the P&L. But that's not the case, because he knows that accumulated leave in a year is only 50. And the employee might take 60, 70, 80 leaves in that year. So again that 300 might come down to 250. Then again in next year it might go to 275. Then again it might come.
So my point is totally different. I am saying, suppose in the first year he doesn't take leave and leave gets accumulated.
Right.
He gets full salary.
Right.
Whatever 240 days right. he is working,
right.
240 days salary is paid to him.
Right.
Next year he takes 50 days leave.
Right.
Now salary will come for 190 days and 50 days he is taking leave.
Right.
That will go from actuarial fund.
Right.
So when we'll prepare the salary bill, this problem will be, you know.
Problem will not come, that's what I am saying. See, you have not understood what calculations actuary does. Actuary will take into account how many leaves you are going to take and how many leaves you are going to encash. The two things which actuary takes
Sir,
into
no,
account.
Not that. I am talking about the payment side. Now, when we make the payment of the services he has rendered, we have to make the payment for the whole year he has worked for the whole year.
Right, absolutely.
Now, actually, he has worked for only 200 days.
Right.
And 40 days he has taken leave. But total period will be counted to 40 days.
Right.
He will be paid for paid towards salary for 200 days and 40 days accumulated leave.
There are two things which I have explained yesterday also, today also I am explaining. One is operation angle, one is accounting angle. Accounting angle will not tell you how much you should pay to the employee. What you are paying today, you will pay tomorrow also, next year also.
But the source of fund will be different, sir.
Source of fund will also not be different. Accounting will not tell you source of fund. Accounting will tell you should create a fund for this in future. Now, you might create a fund, you might not create a fund. If you don't create a fund, accounting will tell you there should be a liability standing in your accounts.
Sir, we have
for this. Sir, if you have already created a fund, accounting will tell you, okay, fine. If you have created a fund, there is no liability. Liability and assets will knock off and there is zero liability.
The point is to understood well that salary head, suppose he renders 200 days, actually, he will get salary for 200 days.
Right.
He will get for 240 days. He will be paid for 240 days. 40 days leave he is taking. Now 40 days actuarial value has already been created last year, this year,
right.
and it has gone to actuarial fund.
Right.
Now that 40 days is to be deducted from actuarial fund, which is being encashed actually.
Right.
So when we'll prepare the salary bill, what kind of salary bill will be prepared?
See, there will be no change in your salary bill. That's what I am explaining. That is operational angle.
But 40 days deduction is to be made from actuarial, that salary component which is getting towards the leave availed.
See, understand this. मैं आपको वही समझा रहा हूँ कि जब मैं लीव नहीं लेता, सपोज आज मैंने लीव नहीं लिया तो भी मुझे 200 दिन का ही सैलरी मिलेगा, 240 का ही दिन. आई वोंट गेट एक्स्ट्रा सैलरी इवन इफ आई डोंट टेक अ लीव. ओके, इवन इफ आई टेक अ लीव नेक्स्ट ईयर विच इज विद इन द लिमिट्स, आई विल स्टिल बी पेड द सेम सैलरी. सो देर इज नो चेंज इन द सैलरी बिल. सैलरी बिल रिमेन सेम. राइट. आई एम जस्ट सेइंग दैट देर शुड बी अ मैचिंग कॉन्सेप्ट. टूडे इफ आई हैव वर्कड एक्स्ट्रा and I have earned extra, there should be a charge created in the P&L today or a fund created in your liability today, so that next year when I want compensation for the extra time I have given, that compensation can be given out of that fund.
Out of that fund only.
Out of that fund.
That fund will get reduced.
Which is what happening today. When you make the payment for encashment, leave encashment, don't you reduce from that fund? You do. In fact, suppose do you have provision for leave encashment on your balance sheet? Yes. If you have a provision for leave encashment on your balance sheet, whenever anyone does leave encashment, don't you reduce that provision? So that is a fund which is being created. And if a person takes extra leave, suppose, you know, try giving actuary a false data. Tell him that all the leaves have been encashed during the year.
Exactly.
Or tell him that everyone has, forget encashment, everyone has gone for a holiday throughout the year. There is no one working throughout the year. The leave encashment provision will automatically come down to zero.
Sir, my point is that only.
So even if there is no encashment, all have gone for leaves, still the leave encashment fund will become zero. Because you are not eligible for any leave encashment.
Sir, my point is that only when we will prepare the chart of account and code of accounts will be prepared, then 200 days salary will go to one particular chart of accounting code and 40 days will go to actuarial code.
No, but I'll tell you how it happens. What I am saying, you are automatically doing, but I am making you realize what you are doing. I am telling you how. Say this is 2012, leave encashment provision, the actuary has asked you to create 1 lakh rupees. Fine, you have simply created expense account debit to provision for leave encashment, 1 lakh rupees. 1 lakh is there in the fund. 2013, some people have taken leave, some people have not taken leave, some people have left, some people have encashed, some people are new joinees. You give all the data to the actuary. What he does, okay, opening 1 lakh. Okay, some people have taken leave. So what I will do, I will take out from this fund. So what I will do is 20,000 I will reduce. Okay, some people, let me complete.
I take the leave in this furniture, for this furniture, I was allowed to take you not from the old balance. Because every year 15, 30 years I am not disturbing for you. From current to the period, I am taking.
Because if you take more than the current year's leave.
I am not taking. I am taking example. I have taken only 15 leave, which is eligible.
Yeah. How much you have paid for the last year?
Huh.
How much you have paid for the last year? That will be deducted from the actuarial valuation.
So
that data you need to provide.
Okay, one second, sir.
Last year though, when the actuary will start calculating, when the actuary will start calculating, he will take the opening balance. At the same time, he will ask you how much you have paid in the last financial year. That will be deducted from the opening balance. And again, the revaluation will take place.
Sir, let me complete. Then we'll discuss all your queries. Let me explain what I am in middle of. I'll answer all your queries. Okay. So what actuary will do? He will take opening balance 1 lakh. Then he will consider how much leaves have been taken from the opening balance. Then he will consider how much leaves have been added to the carry forward. So suppose 30,000 more has been added. So what has happened? Total is 1,10,000. Now he will say what? You create a total provision of 1,10,000. You have an opening of 1 lakh, new provision to be created 10,000. So what you will do? Expense account debit 10,000 to provision for leave encashment 10,000. You are not realizing what you are doing is you are taking out of the fund all the leaves which have been encashed or leaves have been taken excess, and then you are creating more fund for leaves which are carried forward. So this is automatically happening. I am just making you realize what is the calculations behind it, how things happen and why things happen. Is this clear? So you don't have to pass anything out of the fund.
But what actually actuarial does, he gives a percentage that this much percentage should be transferred to the actuarial fund. He doesn't go by yearly calculation. He doesn't take the record from the institute on every year.
Then that's a wrong thing. Then you are not doing actuarial valuation as per accounting standard 15.
That may be wrong. I'm just telling.
I'll show you actuarial valuation reports I have in my presentation, how it happens. If you want, I will show you the entire report from my laptop I have of many companies.
Sir, I agree with you, but practically what is happening is
that
he's okay, telling
11%. Do you from registered valuer or do you take LIC's valuation?
No, registered valuer.
Registered valuer. Do you ask him to do valuation as per AS-15?
I have not checked it because I have joined recently, only last month.
You check the entire report. It will be a detailed report. It will show you calculation. It will show you assumptions. The assumptions which go behind it is how many leaves is expected to be taken. How many people are expected to resign? Because when he resigns, he will encash. How many people are expected to join? Mortality rate. So there are various assumptions, discounting rate, even the rate of funds which are going on, because if you have assets, how much return you will get. So there are various assumptions which an actuary considers before arriving at this 1 lakh or 1,10,000.
If it is done on year to year basis, then it is fine.
It has to be done year to year basis. Okay, so leave encashment is fine. So see, compensated absences or leave encashment, can leave can be of two types: accumulating, non-accumulating. Like we said that CL is non-accumulating, so ignore that. So that is short term and you account for it immediately. How do you account? When you account for salary, you account for that 8 days leave. Okay. Accumulating, accumulating can be vesting or non-vesting. Vesting is something which can be encashed. Non-vesting is something which cannot be encashed. So let us talk about vesting, because that is important for us. Vesting can be two things: short term or long term. Short term means something which can be encashed in next 12 months. Okay, but we have majorly long term vesting thing which can be encashed at retirement. So for long term vesting leaves, you have to go for actuarial valuation, and whatever actuary does calculation, you have to then account for it in your books as provision for leave encashment. Clear? Okay, we are through with short term, because short term, as I said, no discounting and no actuarial valuation. We'll go for post employment. Post employment, there are two kinds: defined contribution plan, defined benefit plan. Okay. Defined contribution, as the name suggests, contribution is defined, benefit is not defined. I'll repeat: defined contribution plan means contribution is defined, benefit is not defined. What I mean to say is, if I am an employer, I know how much is going from my pockets, because that is fixed. Year on year it is fixed. How much benefit can be absorbed by the employees or will be passed on to the employees, that is not fixed. That means how much ever they can get benefit out of this fund is the max they can get. Their benefits is not defined, that is why I am saying contribution is defined. Give an example. Defined contribution is where do you have a fixed contribution year on year and you don't have to make good any balance. See, I'll give two comparisons. I'll take two things. Gratuity on one side and provident fund on another side. Fine. Gratuity on one side, provident fund on another side. How do you calculate the gratuity to be payable?
It is on the basis of 15 years.
There is maximum 10 lakh.
15 years from when I resign. So last salary, basically last salary whenever I resign. Okay. Today, do I know today what will be the last salary of the employee who will resign then? I don't know. It might be anything. Right? So benefit here is fixed. What is the benefit? Whatever you draw last salary, your gratuity will be based on that. Right? So benefit to the employee is fixed, ki last jo bhi aapne draw kiya uske basis pe aapko gratuity mil jayega. Today's contribution not fixed, because I don't know what will be the benefit. I can just estimate it. Okay. Provident fund. Provident fund, how do you calculate? It is today's salary. It is based on today's salary. So whatever is the salary, annual salary, a percentage of that is given as provident fund, right? And when you give it to a recognized provident fund, they give you a fixed percentage interest on it. So interest is also fixed, gross amount is also fixed, interest is also fixed. So whenever you will resign or whenever you will take out of that provident fund, my contribution is fixed today. Whatever I have given today is what max you will get. Us samay pe paise ka jo bhi value hoga, us samay jitna bhi inflation hoga, that is your headache, that is not my headache. I am paying you today into a fund. How much ever you can get benefit out of that fund whenever you withdraw that fund is your headache. It's not my headache as an employer. So it is a defined contribution plan. DCP. Here, बेनिफिट इज फिक्स्ड, मतलब उस समय जो इन्फ्लेशन होगा उसी हिसाब से आपकी सैलरी होगी, उसका परसेंटेज मैं आपको दूंगा. दैट मींस बेनिफिट इज फिक्स्ड, माय टुडेज कंट्रीब्यूशन इज नॉट फिक्स्ड. दिस इज डिफाइंड बेनिफिट प्लान. लॉजिक और प्रिंसिपल इज फाइन, देन वील एक्सट्रापोलेट इन टू द वेरियस बेनिफिट्स दैट यू गेट. ओके, नाउ There are two types of risk actually in any of these plans, whether it is defined contribution or defined benefit plan. The two risks which we always take into consideration is, one is actuarial risk and one is investment risk. जो आपका actuarial valuation होता है, whether it is for gratuity or leave encashment or pension or anything, okay, these two risk is considered, which is actuarial risk and investment risk. What is an actuarial risk? See, I don't know कि उसका gratuity क्या होगा जिस समय वो resign करेगा, right? जिस समय वो resign करेगा, I don't know. So there are two things which I have to do. One is I have to estimate what will be his final salary based on whatever is will be his final salary or final gratuity. That is an estimate. वो final salary suppose मैं बोलता हूँ कि उसकी वो monthly salary होगी say 1 lakh per month. Okay, so 12 lakhs will be his final salary. That is an estimate. वो 12 lakhs आने के लिए what I have to do, I have to वो 12 lakhs आने के लिए suppose I have to invest say 50,000 rupees per annum today. सो दैट 50,000 अभी करता रहूँगा उसके ऊपर मुझे इंटरेस्ट मिलता रहेगा एंड इंटरेस्ट मिल मिल के सम डे वेन एवर ही रिजाइन्स द फंड विच हैव क्रिएटेड फॉर दैट एम्प्लॉई विल कम टू 12 लैक्स आर यू गेटिंग माई पॉइंट सो दैट टू रिस्क विच आर दोज टू रिस्क वन इज द रिस्क दैट इट मे बी मोर देन 12 लैक्स हिज फाइनल सैलरी माइट बी मोर देन और लेस देन 12 लैक्स दैट इज वन रिस्क विच इज कॉल्ड एज एक्चुअल रिस्क सॉरी Right, but my estimate is, see, the ceiling is applicable only when he crosses the ceiling. Everyone might not cross that ceiling. Ceiling change bhi ho sakta hai. Change bhi ho sakta hai. So my risk is whether this 12 lakhs is a final number. It can be more, it can be less. That risk is called as actuarial risk. I am investing 50,000 today so that it becomes 12 lakhs after X number of years when they will resign. That 50,000 per annum will give me a return which will make it 12 lakhs. This risk is an investment risk because I might not get 12 lakhs or I might not get that percentage of return on this 50,000. So there are two risks which is involved in actuarial valuation, which is investment risk and actuarial risk. When it is a defined contribution plan, there is no such risk. There is no actuarial risk, there is no investment risk because the I know exactly what I am paying today and that is all which I have to pay. When it is a defined benefit plan, I have to consider these two things, estimates, and hence these two risks will be there in any actuarial valuation, in any defined benefit plan. Now as I said, defined contribution plan, fixed contributions into a separate entity or fund. See, you might contribute or you might just create a liability. It depends. Now PF is a thing wherein you contribute to a PF fund, a recognized PF fund. So you have a fund. Sometimes in some of the defined contribution plan which your company might have, see it can be anything. I might give some year on year fixed bonus, okay, which I know that this is the fine bonus, but you will get it at the time of retirement. Some company might have it. That can be a defined contribution plan without fund. So fund is optional. No legal or constructive obligation, so there is no obligation to pay further contribution. Contribution is fixed, whatever I am paying today is fixed. Even if the fund does not hold sufficient assets to pay off that liability, it is fund's responsibility. It is recognized provident fund which is there of the government. It is that fund's responsibility to pay to the employee. My responsibility as an employer is over when I pay every year that PF contribution. Every month that PF contribution when I pay, my responsibility is over. That is defined contribution plan. In defined contribution plan, it is very simple. Whatever you pay every month, you recognize as expense. No discounting, no actuarial valuation, nothing to be done. Simple, whatever I contribute to the recognized provident fund, I recognize as expense. Very simple. Any questions on this? No. Defined benefit plan. Defined benefit plan, I said, benefits are fixed. Contributions are not fixed. Okay, do you have a fund in which you deposit gratuity or pension? Do you have a pension fund? Do you have a gratuity fund? Do you give it to anyone or you just create in your balance sheet? Just create in the balance sheet. There is no fund. Okay, some of the companies, private companies, they give it to LIC or there are various funds which they create. They might create trust. So there are various plans which they create. But anyways, now if we don't have any plans, we create just liability in our balance sheet. Okay. Now, if that liability is not enough, that fund which we have created in our balance sheet itself, that account which we have created in our balance sheet itself, suppose it is not enough. That means the calculation of that liability is not perfect. Then whatever is the deficit in that liability fund, I have to make good. Right? So hence, my benefit is fixed, my contribution is not fixed, and obligation to pay further contribution is still with me. So if that liability is not enough, whatever excess has to be paid by me. Gratuity, pension, these are some of the examples of defined benefit plan. Any questions on this? How do you account for this plan? Basically, you go for actuarial valuation. You give all the details to the actuary. Actuary will calculate and give you the amount which you should provide for. The provision entry will be expense account debit to liability. And whenever you pay off that liability to the employees, the entry will be liability debit to bank. This is what you do currently?
Suppose every year we are creating liability by debiting.
Huh.
By doing it, after some years, we will create 1,000 crores of liability without having any money. Because the government does not accept it and they will not provide fund. They provide only at the time of retirement, not before that. We are going on making provision every year.
Right.
After 10, 20, 15 years, this balance sheet become just aggregation of some figures, but will not match with the actual statement.
In your balance sheet,
because what happened, just I'm telling one thing. 1 year back when this thing was started in UGC, I started this question and asked from financial advisor of UGC or MHRD, whether we will provide fund to us or not for the making this provision. It was denied categorically. No, we are not going to provide any fund for the provision. We will provide you fund only at the time of actual retirement of the employee concerned.
Of the employees. That is why private companies go for this LIC fund or some trust.
Yes, yes.
So that they can earn interest, fixed interest, and they make payments every year.
Private company and corporate sector,
there is no huge burden on you.
Private sector and corporate sector, they are making provision and it seems reasonable.
Right.
But in government organization, only this figure calculations and figure put in balance sheet and this and that where. But no fund is being provided by the government for balancing these things. It is almost 100%.
We are creating provision for this, but if government will not provide any fund against this provision, then what is the
Government will have to provide because
government is not providing. Government is only providing when any employee is going to retirement.
So at that time, government will provide. Whenever the employee will retire, it is their responsibility to provide you pension.
This
gratuity
is not yet settled. Number of time I asked this question in UGC also.
These are autonomous bodies, but they feel they are handicapped.
Sir,
you see, past, present, and future. These are the three Kal we always talk about. Past, present, and future. Today, we are standing at present. Today, we are talking about actuary, liability, this and that. 10 years back, even 2 years back, did anybody talk about it? So, we are looking forward future. So, why do you not do, after doing actuary and every year you start creating a provision and transfer a bit of your fund to that fund, budget to that fund? It is a percentage, 5%, 2%, 3%, or maximum 5%. Why are you looking to government for everything? Why do you are autonomous body, you have your own income?
Sir, Bakshi
sir. So, that is what we are going to tell
you. Bakshi sir.
Look
sir,
to the present and future.
Sir, Bakshi sahab, autonomy jo hai no, bada misnomer shabd hai. Autonomy only for academics.
This is going not to
happen. Autonomy for finance and
past government will take over. But present and future, why do you
sir, finance mein koi autonomy nahi hai.
Standing on your legs.
Sir, finance mein koi autonomy nahi hai. Yah to bahut spasht hai. No autonomy for finance.
Now, UGC is telling this, from this fund is available with you.
We are tracking this part.
There are so many things we do, I know. And from that you can do so many things. What are you doing in the field? We also know a little bit. You can create fund, you can tell UGC that this is fund we are maintaining for this. UGC will not cut it out.
Thank you, sir.
In the when there was a conversion from CPF to GPF in the year probably last was 97, and UGC had instructed that we should create a fund out of the employer's contribution of CPF. So accordingly, a pension fund was created. Subsequently, there was clear instruction from UGC to dissolve the fund and use it as a non-plan expenditure so that no fund should be created for pensionary benefits.
This is another problem. Yes, this is practical problem. Okay. If you take the responsibility, we have no objection.
Please.
Sir, in case of old pension scheme,
In case of old pension schemes,
there is a certainty that these are the terminal benefits we should provide to the employee.
Right.
But in case of NPS, the people who have joined after 2004, what are the terminal benefits we should provide for in our balance sheet? That is not clear. So, for that, what sort of provision we have to make?
I can talk about accounting. I cannot talk about creation of funds and provisions.
Sir, problem is that in case of self-sufficient body like CBSE, there is absolutely no problem because we are managing with our own funds. We can create any fund.
Right.
But in case of grants, when the organization is depending on the grants of the government, there is no scope for creating this liability because the limited funds are there. And another peculiar thing is that government follows cash accounting and autonomous body follows accrual accounting. This is also is a big mismatch.
So government is also in process of shifting to accrual system.
They don't recognize the accrual accounting. The point is that now suppose you say
there is no provision for creation of this fund. What is the use
of this actuarial valuation is you show to the government, see this is the liability for which you should create a fund. So that is the use of this actuarial valuation.
That is true. That's what I am telling. Government is following cash accounting. They can't create that kind of fund.
They are also slowly shifting towards accrual. Wait for some time. It's a slow change. It cannot happen overnight. So it might take time. Parts and pieces of government will move towards accrual basis. Any particular defined benefit plan or any particular employee benefit you want me to discuss?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Education is treated as a service sector.
Right.
So our government is treated as accounting standard is treated as a business.
Accounting standards are equally applicable to service sector and manufacturing sector or any sector.
It is
applicable to any organization which is not for profit.
My question is it correct or not?
What?
Accounting standard treated in service sector, business sector or manufacturing sector, all are treated as equal. Is it correct or not?
It is equal. Accounting standards are applicable to all of them.
Is it correct or not, your opinion?
Yes, why not?
my opinion is different.
No, we'll discuss such things later on. Let's discuss the topic first. Okay, this is an example of actuary report, how I've just taken extracts of an actuary report. You can see first one is present value of defined benefit obligation. Defined benefit plan, defined benefit obligation is same. So first they are defining what is defined benefit obligation, then they are discounting it and bringing up a present value. Okay, if you have any assets in front of it, they will do a fair value of assets. If you don't have any fund or assets in front of it, there is no fair value. Whether there is any fund or no fund, if there is no fund, then funded status will show a deficit equivalent to defined benefit obligation. Okay. Then there is past service cost. What is past service cost? Past service cost is when a plan changes. So suppose you had a pension plan, which is a new pension plan, old pension plan. The pension plan changed. Okay. Now, what this past service cost says is, when a plan changes and because of change in plan, the effect is retrospective. That means even the existing employees will be paid more benefits because of the services which have been already provided in previous years. That will go into past service cost. So, past service cost, if you want me to repeat, okay, a plan changes. So, suppose previously I was giving 5% of the salary, I will change the plan and I make it 5.5% of the salary. So, say 5% of your last salary was the previous plan. Okay. Now, I will pay 5.5% of your last salary. Okay. So, I am changing the plan, and changing the plan is applicable even to existing employees. Say. Okay. So, employees who have already provided service till this date, okay, for every year I should accrue some portion so that at the end of the year I can pay off from the fund. Now, these years have already elapsed. So, whatever of this 5.5% I should have accrued in these years, that portion will go into past service cost. So, there is current service cost, there is past service cost, which you call as arrears, right? So, that past service cost is used for that portion. So, that you show it separately, that this portion is not because of current service, it is because of past service. And then you get net asset or liability, which you have to recognize in the balance sheet. Similarly, for income and expenditure, you have current service cost, interest cost, expected return on assets if you have any. Okay, curtailment or settlement does not happen in government sector, so we can ignore that. Then there's past service cost. Okay, actuarial gains and losses. What is actuarial gains and losses? You have seen on your actuary report, actuarial gains and losses? No. There's no actuarial gains and losses in your actuary report. Have you gone through your actuary report in detail? Yes? They don't have these actuary gains and losses? They have, right? Have you wondered what it is? No, many of them said they do actuarial valuation every year.
The actuarial concept came only in 2002-03 when the accrual accounting system came in existence.
2002-03?
2003 only. We have shifted from cash to accrual only in 2002-03, government sector. At that time, actuarial also in the government sector, they just gave the percentage. Ki every year, this much percentage is the actuarial value of the employees based on certain data which we have provided to the actuary. And simply 11% or 12% or whatever percentage they have told, that much fund is being
created every year. Why do you need an actuary report if you know the percentage?
That's what I'm telling. In our case, we are not receiving any actuarial
report. Actuarial report. Okay, how many of you all receive actuarial report? Only one or two. Okay, so this actuarial valuation is required as per AS-15 mandatory every year for all of you all, wherever there is leave encashment, gratuity which is there with all of you all, pension is there with all of you all. So you have to get this done, actuarial valuation. Actuarial valuation, I showed samples or extracts of the report, this is how it looks. You have to provide for those expenses based on actuarial valuation report, that is mandatory. Okay, actuarial valuation will have this actuarial gains and losses. I said there is something called as actuarial risk. Okay, actuarial risk is how much amount will be, my liability will be whenever that liability arises. That risk or that value is based on certain assumptions. Now, if those assumptions change, those assumptions are bound to change because these are estimates. Whenever those assumptions change, you will find an amount in actuarial gains and losses. Actuarial gains and losses are created because of change in assumptions. Variation from the estimates, that goes to actuarial gains and losses. Okay, these are the normal assumptions: discount rate, expected return on assets, salary escalation rates, mortality rates, withdrawal rates. These are the basic assumptions which an actuary takes to arrive at the value which they will give it to you. And these assumptions can change, like if you see discount rate 8% to 9.25%. So that change will get you actuarial gains and losses. Okay, there are two questions. Suppose employee has not completed 5 years of service. Should I go for actuarial valuation of that employee also for gratuity? Yes, you should. Because when he completes 5 years, he will get for previous 5 years also. It's not that it starts from sixth year. In private sector also it is not payable. My point is, if he completes 5 years, suppose he is in the sixth year, will you pay for 6 years or will you pay for only 1 year? I'll pay for 6 years, right? So I don't want that liability of all the 6 years coming in 1 year. Hence, I should create every year, even though he has not completed 5 years. Yes, there will be some estimates whether that employee will stay there for 6 years or more than 5 years. If my estimate is that employee will stay there for more than 5 years, I should start charging my P&L for gratuity. Sorry? Right, gratuity is defined under the Gratuity Act, payable only after 5 years.
Now, it will be due after 5 years, sir.
Huh?
So if it is not due, then how we can provide the liability?
See, there is a difference between accrual and due. What is difference between accrual and due? One second. What is difference between accrual and due?
No difference, sir. In accrual basis, we are doing only that. If it is due or not.
Let me answer. Okay. You if you borrow funds, okay, and you have to pay interest. When is the interest due?
Interest due?
After every month? Say 1st of every month or 6th of every month?
Yes, yes.
The due date of interest. Suppose your electricity bill or your telephone bill.
Yes.
When is the bill due?
On the last date.
On the last date, say 31st or 1st or 5th of every month, right? Yes. When does it accrue?
When does... No. From the day one.
It accrues daily.
During that period.
Accrual is daily accrual. Accrual means daily. You can have even hourly accrual. You can have even minute accrual. Accrual is point by point.
Yes, yes, yes.
Due is when? After every month.
Yes, sir, yes.
So there is difference between accrual and due?
In that sense, it is different.
In any sense, it is different. Accrual is different from due. Sir. Due is when there is a due date which can be defined by you and me. Sir. Suppose I give you loan, I define that you have to pay interest after every year.
Sir, sir.
So due date is after every year. It is understanding between two people. Due date can be anything.
Sir.
But it will accrue every day.
Sir.
For both of us.
If that sir institute closed before 5 years, then what happened regarding that gratuity?
See, there are two things. One is, if he leaves before 5 years, first of all, I am saying when I create a provision for gratuity, sir, I have to estimate how many people will leave before 5 years.
Sir.
So suppose say I say 70% of people will stick for 5 years.
Sir, can 30% I able to know?
Let me complete. 30% will leave before 5 years. That is my estimate. I create provision based on this estimate. Okay. Suppose 40% leave before 5 years. My estimate was 30. 40 people leave before 5 years, that means I created excess provision, I don't have to pay that, I reverse that provision. And suppose only 20% leave before 5 years, that means my estimate was 30% will leave, only 20% left, that means my provision is short, I create more provision. So these are estimates. It can go wrong, estimates are actually never perfect. Right? So I will never come to know how many people will leave. But it's an estimate. It is bound to change. And bound to change every year, not only after 5 years. Every year you have to re-estimate. Will this 70% hold true or 65 or 75? And that work will be done by actuary, not you. So when I say that these are the assumptions, see this mortality rate. There is something also called as how many people will leave every year. That is also estimated by the actuary. So it is not to be done by you. They will do it based on the past experience in the government sector or in your organization. They will estimate future. So that's how
one
you do
question,
it. So
sir,
even if it is not 5 years, even if the employee has just joined, you should start thinking whether I should create a provision for gratuity for that employee.
One question, sir.
No, in private sector also it is not payable before 5 years. Till the time he retires. Huh. But it is, one second, but it is payable when he retires and it is payable for the entire service years. So if he gives service for 30 years, after 30 years I have to pay him for the 30 years gratuity.
The computation part, it is okay, sir. The computation what you have told is acceptable.
But the payment of gratuity I was referring to.
I understand payment is after 30 years. But if I don't create a provision every year, see, I am paying him, why am I paying him gratuity? Because he has provided me service in that year, say first year or say second year. I am paying him gratuity for that year. Now he has provided me service. Out of that service, as I said, when he provides me service, he creates revenue for me. And if I am paying him for creating that revenue in that year, I should make a provision in that year. They are not paying you gratuity for the 30th year. They are not paying you gratuity for the 6th to 30th year. They are paying gratuity from 1st to 30th year. Hence, cost should be debited in that year's account. That is why we create provision.
Yeah, well taken.
Excuse me, sir. I've read the reports of the actuary.
Huh.
Though there are certain places that I do not understand. This is an expertise work. So, all right, we employees, all the recruits, details are provided. DA orders we got in March raised to 100%, but it accrues from January. So we are provided at 100% DA.
Huh.
Though we have not paid, we have provided the details at 100% DA. So, but then my doubt is on the pensioners.
Right.
Pensioners, what other benefits would accrue to the pensioners except dearness relief? So what would the actuary evaluate for the pensioners when they will not earn any more service benefits?
Again, see, you have to go to the basic of it, that how does...
It's only the dearness allowance that the dearness relief that accrues to them from January that is... has to be evaluated.
My question is,
calculated.
How do you calculate the pension liability?
As an employee, when he has not retired, I'm talking about a pensioner, when he has pension off, he has no more salary benefits except pension and dearness relief.
So when he provided the services, I created a liability. So see, forget the past. Okay, let's talk about future. So now, suppose I have joined government service. I provide service for 30 years. And then I leave that service and I live for another 15 years. So every 15 years or even after that, I will keep on getting my pension, right? Now, when I provide service for 30 years, a liability is created every year and the fund is created, whether funded or not, but at least the amount is there in my balance sheet. I will keep on disbursing that amount to that pensioner from this fund. Hence, there is a requirement to create fund so that when he becomes a pensioner, I can disburse amount using this fund. It is not a burden on me in the year when he becomes pensioner. It becomes burden on me when he earns. It's like if I earn today and I take care of my retirement, I am creating a fund today onwards for my retirement. After retirement, I cannot think, yaar, mere paas paise hi nahi bacha. I should start creating fund for my retirement today onwards, right? That's what government should do, or that's what any company should do. They should take care of a retirement from today when I am earning and healthy.
Still, sir, I'm not clear. Anyway, because about a pensioner does not earn any more service benefits. It's pension and dearness relief only.
See, pensioner gets money because
and
he provided me service in a particular year.
First March every year.
See, pensioner gets money because he provides me service. He has already provided me service in a particular year. That is why he is getting pension today. So he has earned that pension when he provided me service. See, that's why I said it is a defined benefit. Benefit is fixed, that I have to take care of that pensioner throughout his life. Contribution is not fixed. So
but
I have
then
to
longevity does not matter, no, sir, here, because we are sending for valuation accrued us at 31st March 2014. So it is us at that date. It's not for the future to that.
No, we create liability for future in the current year. You are...
Okay, all right.
Provision for gratuity, we are creating provision for the retirement.
You are not creating provision for pension.
No, I am asking questions.
Provision should be created for pension.
Pension
is also a defined benefit plan.
I got the question.
Yes, pension is also a defined benefit plan. See, whatever benefits you give to an employee, you have to first list down like we did today. Okay, then you have to define it, whether it is a defined contribution plan, whether it is a defined benefit plan, whether it is long-term benefit, short-term benefit, you have to define that.
in case of new pension scheme, what are the provision we are supposed to take? That is leave encashment, gratuity, what are the provisions we are supposed to take?
See, understand, you have to first list down what is the benefits you are providing to the employee, whether it is leave encashment, pension, gratuity, any whatever benefits you provide to the employee. Then you have to classify it whether it is a defined benefit plan or defined contribution plan.
Defined benefit plan, because new pension
right.
is a defined
if
benefit plan.
If it is a defined
plan.
Benefit plan, you have to give details of the plan and details of the employee to the actuary. Then actuary will calculate how much provision you should create and give it to you. That much provision you should make in your accounts.
Yes, but my question is whether gratuity fund or leave encashment, whether this provision will be accounted for new pension or not?
Yes, it will be.
Yes,
that
sir.
Means gratuity
we
and leave salary both will be accounted
sir.
For.
All of them, yes.
Except
all
for
NPS.
Pension.
Okay.
For
pension is also defined benefit
yes,
plan.
Yes.
Yes.
So we send for valuation for the NPS, we send for valuation only gratuity and the leave encashment.
You have to do also for pension. That's
no,
what
we
I'm
don't
saying.
Send, sir. Because it's a contribution, it's a contributory fund.
No, why do you
pension
say it's a
pension is a contributory.
Okay, why do you say it's a contributory fund? How do you calculate pension?
That is taken care by a central regulatory agency, sir.
So in new pension scheme, you just make contribution to the government and whatever is the pension liability, government will take care. After your retirement. Okay, then in new pension scheme, it's a defined contribution plan.
Hello, sir.
Bolie.
Actually, her question was actually whether gratuity is entitled under new pension scheme or not.
Oh, that
this
I do not know.
This is the question because somebody is confused.
I can answer your accounting related queries. I cannot answer your operations related
then,
queries.
Then it is a question to Mr. Bokshi whether it is under, because I have to provision for gratuity or not. I have to take provision for gratuity or
sir,
not.
Sir,
any operations related query, Mr. Bokshi will answer tomorrow last session.
Okay.
But,
okay. Let's talk about accounting now.
Thank you.
But sir, but in new pension scheme also, leave encashment is payable by the department. So provision
so,
is to made for leave encashment.
So what, see, leave encashment is not a post-employment benefit. It is either short term or other long term. So it cannot be defined contribution or defined benefit plan. It can, leave encashment is either short term or other long term. In our case, it will be other long term benefits and you have to go for actuarial valuation.
And provide the life.
Yeah, regarding this,
yes.
Clear?
NPS thing is not defined benefit, neither it is a defined benefit nor defined contribution. Actually, the money is getting deposited to NSDL. Whatever is the loss will go to the employee account. So that year itself it gets charged. No actuarial provision is required. So
that's what we just discussed. That you know, when you pay to the government and the final.
It's not going to government. It's not going to government. It's NSDL is investing in stock market. Whatever is the loss, employee has to bear. So now no provision is required for that.
So fine, it becomes then defined contribution plan.
Hello,
yes,
sir.
Yes.
Please clear me one thing. Whether gratuity provision is required under the employees who are covered under NPS, New Pension Scheme Act. So because we have to, if it is covered, then we have to consider in the accounts as a provision, otherwise not. So
see,
it is clear, clarification
is required.
In
New Pension Scheme, gratuity will be paid off by the government. You will pay, your institute will pay some amount every year to the government and the final payment will be made by the government.
Exactly.
Then it is a defined contribution plan for you.
So
because your contribution is fixed.
Okay.
You don't have to make good if any shortage or excess, you don't have to take care of that, right?
Right.
Then it is a defined contribution plan for you.
Okay.
So I have explained you what is defined contribution plan. It, you don't have to go for actuarial valuation, you just have to account for only whatever you pay every year.
Sir, presently,
fine?
Presently okay. Very unique situation is prevailing because the government has not come out with the detailed pension payment plan under NPS. What they have told that organizations where retirement cases are there or death cases are there, they have to pay from their own sources despite the fact that payments have been made towards NPS to the agencies, NSDL and Axis Bank. That is a unique situation prevailing.
It's a temporary phase. In future, all the payments will
so
be
So once they will clarify, then you can rethink whether it is a defined contribution or defined benefit plan.
It is defined, but the government has not come out with the detailed pension payment plan. Okay. How much benefits will be paid? So temporarily, they are telling the organizations to make the payment.
Let's take one last question, then we take a break for tea. Suppose the institute itself has not completed 5 years. Do you still need to make a provision for gratuity? Yes. The answer will remain same whether it is employee has completed 5 years or not, or institute has completed 5 years or not. You have to create provision for gratuity. Let's move for break and then we join again.